Hey guys, this is in memory of Elizabeth Reed, and it has some great musical movements. We'll get to those later, but first I want to talk about the band. This was recorded in March of 1971 at the Fillmore East. And just 8 months prior, Duane Allman recorded Layla with Eric Clapton and Derek and the Dominoes. So Eric Clapton heard Duane Allman on a Wilson Pickett song and invited him to do this record. Apparently the first night they met, they played all through the night and into the next day, and they became musical brothers instantly. If Eric had had his way, Duane would have been in Derek and the Dominoes and would have quit the Allman Brothers. Eric really wanted him in the band, and even to the point where I think Duane did a couple of TV appearances with Derek and the Dominoes and then went back to the Allmans. But it's pretty amazing that just 8 months prior, you know, Duane Allman and Eric Clapton together did one of the greatest guitar songs of all time. Now, the thing that amazes me about Duane Allman at this point, he was really fully developed as a traditional lead guitar player. There is no slide on this song. So if you look at footage from this concert in this era, he's playing lead guitar, fingers on frets, actually in a more polished and formed way than Dickie Betts. Now, Dickie Betts came into his own fully a couple of years later, and in fact, he led the band and wrote their biggest song and really, you know, came into his own. But Duane, at that point, was a very polished and poised lead guitar player and not slide playing. So you take this band and everybody pulls their weight. You have Greg Allman with his amazing voice and writing, you know, Midnight Rider. Then you have Duane Allman with, you know, his ability to play slide, maybe best in the world, people consider. And then Dickie Betts, who took over and actually wrote their biggest songs and their biggest hits. Now, this was a live record because they were frustrated. The Allman Brothers did two records that did okay, and they were studio records, but the Allman Brothers loved this relationship with the audience, and they loved playing long songs. And so they fought for it, and they got the label to agree to do this live record. So the label, they kind of did a smart thing. They sold the double album for the price of a single album. I think one of the sides on the record was Whipping Post at 22 minutes and 50 seconds. And the reputation of Elizabeth Reed was that it would go on for 30 minutes sometimes. So even to this day, I think they are the biggest influence on like jam bands that have been able to do super long versions of their songs in front of audiences. So the other cool thing is that this concert, they were the third bill. It was Johnny Winter first, Elvin Bishop next, and the Allman Brothers third. But this record did really well. It went up the charts immediately, and within 6 months, it had gone gold. So they finally got to do what they wanted to do, which was show this connection with their audience. And what they would do, they were on the road 300 days a year, and they would drop into different cities just to record these records. But it was frustrating because the songs didn't allow them to stretch out. So they would drop into Macon, Georgia, or Miami, Florida, or New York, and do these studio records. But they really wanted to do this live record, and it really popped for them. So the other thing that happened when this record went gold around that time, that's when Duane Allman had his accident and left us. So I just want to show you a quick little documentary of what happened on the day that Duane Allman. Left us.
On October 21st, 1971, Duane took a short ride on his Harley-Davidson Sportster to Barry Oakley's two-story band headquarters and residence the group called The Big House in Macon. He was going to wish Oakley's wife Linda a happy birthday. Shortly after leaving The Big House at about 5:45 p.m., Duane headed east out on Macon on Hillcrest Avenue. It was at the intersection of Hillcrest and Bartlett that Duane spotted a flatbed truck crossing Hillcrest from his left to his right. The truck suddenly stopped in the intersection, forcing Duane to swerve sharply to the left. At this point, Duane clipped the back of the truck's bed and was thrown from the motorcycle. Duane's Sportster flew in the air, landed on him, and slid between 50 and 90 feet beyond the point of impact. Duane's girlfriend, Dixie Meadows, and Barry Oakley's sister, Candy, were following him from some distance behind and had not seen the accident. When the girls found Duane under his motorcycle, they stayed with him until an ambulance arrived. Although Duane was alive when he arrived at the Macon Medical Center, his massive injuries were too much for his body, despite 3 hours of surgery.
So another very, very amazing thing about this is that Duane Allman passed away 30 months after he started the band. You think about the amazing amount of work that they did and the history he made in 30 months. So when he passed away, not only did they go on, Dickie Betts kind of took over as the leader. I mean, Greg Allman was always the face and the voice of the band, but Dickie Betts kind of took over as the leader. And a couple of years later, they had their biggest hit ever, which was Ramblin' Man. And he wrote and sang that and played amazing lead guitar on it. At that point, they exploded. They leased the Rolling Stones 707 jet, okay? Zeppelin had used it, the Stones had used it, and now the Allman Brothers leased it. And they were getting $100,000 a night, which we figured out translates to about $600,000 a night in today's dollars. And the only problem was that's when they started just arguing and living excessively. And Craig Allman's quote was, "When we got that jet, it was over for us." So it was the success was kind of hard on them because they just started arguing and, you know, living in too grand of a way. And then the other thing was Greg Allman actually in 1975 started a relationship with Cher and they got married. And I read this amazing story where they did a couple of records, a Greg Allman solo record and a Cher duet record. They did well enough they could go to Europe and actually tour on those two records. But apparently they had to cancel the tour because there were Allman Brothers fans in the audience and Cher fans in the audience, and they would start fighting. And so they had to cancel that tour. Pretty amazing story. Now, after that, they had amazing people in the band, Derek Trucks, Warren Haynes. So anyway, there's a sale on the Masterclass with this live stream, 14-day free trial. Click the link below if you want guitar lessons. So I'm going to play along with the double time part of this, which is really fun for 1 minute, and then we'll take some questions. Let me just play. Christopher, you're asking about the backing tracks. This is the real master. So the Allman Brothers will pick up the copyright on this YouTube video and earn all the money from it. But I use Isotope, and you can use Moises, and we separate tracks. And that's what we do. It is the actual master. And I've taken out the guitars and the vocals, and then I'm playing along with it. Now, at the beginning, I'm playing along with the lead guitars, too. So there's a little bit of editing going on, but check out Moises or Isotope if you want to do the same thing. I think Moises, from what I hear, is an app you can put on your phone or your iPad, so it's really cool. So anyway, this song goes through some amazing musical movements. I want to play you one little film of one of the other movements in this song, and I want you to notice the two guitars that are being played. Dwayne Allman is playing a Les Paul. Dickie Betts, even though he's not very well lit in this video, Dickie Betts is playing an SG. But this will give you a real feel for how they sounded and what they looked like at this particular moment in time. Play along one more time. Once again, sale on the Masterclass, 14-day free trial if you need guitar lessons. Thanks for joining, guys. finally slipped those octaves in there. You know, I just keep trying to change it up and not overplay, but that's hard to do. Yeah, P90s would be great on a gold top. I've had a couple of those in my life, and they sound really good. They're just noisy. You have to face that with a P90 pickup. It's just going to be noisy. But I always hide noise with my volume pedal. I think you guys know that. My volume pedal is like the gas pedal on a car. When I play a phrase, it opens, and when I finish a phrase, it goes down. And that's how I hide noise 100% of the time. The EQ pedal is set in an interesting way today. I am rolling off the very top and then boosting the gain. I found that I was getting a little bit of a pingy edge to this. Right, you hear that? So if I pick too hard, it really accentuates it. But I kind of mitigated that by rolling off the top end. I mean, every sound you make is a custom sound. Every day is the first day of school. These are 9 through 42. They are elixirs because I like the coating. The elixir coating is so smooth and they last, you know, like 2 years on a guitar. So there are lots of great coated strings. I recommend them. D'Addario has, I learned it's pronounced D'Addario. D'Addario has really good coated strings, but I like the elixirs. They just feel the smoothest. It's a particular coating they use, so I stick with them, and they last forever. So they really are a good value, even though they are expensive. So gotta play again. Here we go. So fun. A minor Dorian, key of G major. You know, if you just learn your modes, you can play all the songs ever written. I really recommend it. Yeah, Les Pauls are, you know, in some ways, I think the greatest sounding guitars ever made. They can be quite heavy. So when I search for a Les Paul, I try and find a lighter body or a chambered body. You know, 8.5 pounds is about as heavy as I want a Les Paul to be. I got this one because it was super lightweight. It's a little bit bright, and it's a little bit far on the meter of cherry sunburst for me. You know, it's very, very yellow and red. I would prefer it if it was more, you know, in the brown, you know, finish area, more like iced tea burst, dirty lemon burst, that kind of thing. But this guitar had the neck profile, and it's incredibly light. It's a little over 7 pounds, and it's not chambered. So it's kind of a unicorn in that way. Anyway, once again, sale on the Masterclass. Click the link below if you want guitar lessons. There's a 14-day free trial. You can opt out if it's not right for you. So this time, I'm going to try the bridge pickup. And for me with the bridge pickup, it's always been a bit of a fight because it always sounds a bit harsh to me. So I work really hard to mitigate that. One thing I do is I turn down the tone knob. Jeff Mackerlang taught me that. But the other thing I've learned to do lately, when I use the bridge pickup, I pick lightly. And that actually gives me the best tone. That's been the biggest secret for me about not getting a harsh tone out of the bridge pickup when I solo, is to pick lightly. And then, of course, I can pick hard for effect at times. Let me try that. Bridge pickup, picking lightly. Here we go. Yeah, and then near the end, I started hitting it hard, and some of that kind of aggressive edge is pleasant after you've played light for a little while, but that's my secret. A lot of the tone is in the picking hand, and I've always been able to really strike hard, and that's one of the reasons I got so much work forever as a session musician because I really would hit the guitar hard, but I've also learned to back way off because frankly there are better tones when you play light, and this is a perfect example. That's sweeter than. But both are useful at different times. The reverb I have on now is the Little Plate by Soundtoys. I'm also using Echo Boy by Soundtoys too. So how are your slide chops? Oh, they're basic. So check it out. I'll show you, give you an example. They're basic, my slide chops. I can do a little bit, but I leave the slide to the pros. You know, we know some amazing slide players, don't we? Yeah, what Duane did in his short life. I mean, I told the story in another video. In 1969, spring 1969, Duane sent his brother Greg Allman some money so he could buy a car. It was a Mustang. So he could drive from L.A. to Jacksonville, Florida, and audition for the Allman Brothers, because Greg was still in L.A. trying to make it in L.A. as a musician. And when Greg actually auditioned for the Allman Brothers, they weren't buying it at first, and then he played him this song, Dreams. I don't know if you know Dreams, that's one of my favorites. I did a video about it. Maybe we can find that link to that video. Anyway, Dreams, when he played Dreams with the band, they were sold. So he actually had to audition to be in his brother's band, and then of course that voice is like, it's one of my favorite voices in rock. Midnight Rider, I could listen to 100 times. It's just beautiful. What do I use the racks for? Well, I used to use racks in the 80s, but this rack is for mic pre's, some effects. Here's a compressor, another mic pre. Here's the Apogee A to D converter. This is a mixer. So it's mainly, this is like a recording studio desk that you would traditionally see spread out like this, but it's here in this rack. And of course, in the 80s and the 90s, I had the big Bradshaw rig and the big rack, so I could sound like Mike Landau and Dan Huff and all those guys. D'Addario, yes. I had a wonderful gentleman who corrected me about that. Maybe it was you, Bent Tom. D'Addario. I will forever get that right now. Beginner section is good. I like that. I will add to the beginner section too in the masterclass. For those of you who are beginners, there is a 100 video beginner section in the masterclass, and I'll keep adding to it too, but it's pretty big. You can get a lot out of it, and it starts at the very, very beginning. So yeah. Anyway, a couple more times playing. Thanks again for joining. I appreciate that. Here a couple. I did this yesterday. You know, I did the same live stream, but a much more extended version yesterday for all my masterclass members. And if you join the masterclass, then you can do that with us. Another really, really interesting part of the story is that Barry Oakley, the bass player, basically died a year later in a motorcycle accident three blocks from where Duane Allman died on his motorcycle. And whereas Duane clipped the back, I guess, of a flatbed, Barry Oakley clipped a bus. And it was literally three blocks from where Duane had passed. And it was 1 year later. I mean, you can't write this stuff. I mean, it's truth is stranger than fiction, I have to say. Anyway, guys, I'm going to play a couple more times, take a couple more questions. Oh, did I ever work with Lukather? Absolutely. When I first moved here, we did a couple of records together, and he's even better than you think. I've heard him go into crazy Larry Carlton mode just in between songs once. No, Steve Lukather, I mean, he plays drums great. He plays piano great. He sings great. His talent was always deep. And when I moved to L.A. in the 80s, you know, he was occasionally doing a session. Toto was huge. So sessions were basically selective for him. He would show up, you know, and do a special appearance for something for somebody. But I got to work with him a couple of times, and he was better. It's just the versatility that these guys had. You know, you would see them do one thing in Toto, but his versatility as far as jazz and blues and rhythm guitar, R&B guitar, Just an incredibly well-rounded musician. He was that way when he was young. So I still love him. I think he's playing great today. I think he's getting great tones today. I love the way his left hand touches the guitar. That's just something about the way his hands touch the guitar. I kind of think I try and emulate that. He's a nice guy, too. Had dinner with him a number of weeks ago. He took us out to dinner, actually, at his favorite sushi place. So he's a good dude. Works hard. On the road with Toto all the time. On the road with Ringo Starr. And, yeah, great guitar player. It's funny. I never do that. You know, we just hammer on one note. But it's really effective. Sometimes the simplest things on lead guitar are so effective. Repetition and just hammering a note and make it, you know, just make it last forever. You know, when you get on stage and you realize you have to capture people and keep their attention, it's a whole different vocabulary sometimes that you end up using. Anyway, everybody, we're at the end here. Thanks so much for joining. I'll see you on the next one. Check out the sale on the Masterclass if you want lessons. And I really appreciate all your support. Have a great Saturday. Try and stay cool, if that's even possible right now. And I'll play us out, and we'll see you on the next one. Thanks again. Here we go.